Good morning, everyone, and thank you for being here. Our hearing will now come to order. I want to welcome everyone to the Energy and Environment Subcommittee's hearing on FutureGen and the Department of Energy's advanced coal programs. I'd like to thank our expert panel of witnesses for being here today, and I look forward to hearing your testimony about the potential role advanced coal technologies, including carbon capture and storage, may play in helping to solve the daunting challenge.
To coal, and that is that Duke Energy would like to build a nuclear power plant or two, but the question is whether you can do that effectively or whether it's really just easier and cheaper to build coal plants. We're not so dependent on the jobs associated with coal. There are some parts of our country that are, but we're the users. We're the people that burn coal because it's a pretty cheap way to make electricity, especially if you have no accountability for what's coming out of the smokestack. And so the question then is whether something can be done to clean up that coal. We've had a number of hearings in this committee about sequestration, that sort of thing, because we can clean, we know we can burn it cleanly. General Electric has a number of proven models that show that you can basically separate out the hydrogen, burn that, and that's pretty exciting. Still, you've got the CO2 issue. So the question is whether we can figure out a way to really improve that process or have some sort of breakthroughs that would make it possible to continue that employment in some places in the country that are dependent on coal and somehow control the CO2 problem. That's certainly our hope in this FutureGen program, and so we look forward to hearing from the witnesses about what the future may be. And it's interesting to note that folks like Duke Energy are not alone. We use lots of coal, and figuring out ways to make it cleaner and to collect up those the CO2 would be an incredible breakthrough. So we look forward to hearing from the witnesses, Mr. Chairman, and hope that there is some way to break through to truly clean coal. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I'd like to, at this point, recognize the gentleman, Mr. Costello, who has been a very, very influential and interested party on this issue. And Mr. Costello, we welcome your remarks.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. And I have a statement that I will enter into the record, make some brief comments concerning the GAO report and the purpose of this hearing. But first, let me not only thank you for recognizing me, but also for calling this hearing today. And thank you as well for joining Chairman Gordon and Mr. Lipinski and I in requesting this GAO report. As you noted, I guess it's been over 5 years now that I've been involved with this project. And in fact, I think everyone knows that over one half of our electricity is generated from coal. Coal is the cheapest form of electricity generation, and we have coal reserves just in my home state of Illinois that contains more BTUs than oil reserves in Saudi Arabia and Kuwait. Like everyone, I want our nation's energy policy to help reduce carbon emissions and to address the climate change issue that we are all facing. But in order to meet these goals, our dependence on coal requires significant investment in clean coal technologies to burn coal as efficiently and as cleanly as possible. And the reality is that our dependence on coal as an energy source is not going away anytime soon. And as you noted in your opening statement, we are not the only nation that is reliant on coal as an energy source. China, as you said, they are actually constructing one coal-fired plant every week now in China. When we develop clean coal technology here in this country, countries like China, India, and other countries will, in fact, hopefully use that technology to achieve our goal. I want to say that when the President announced in the State of the Union address in 2003, President Bush, this was his initiative, the FutureGen project. I was excited about it to the extent that after listening to the State of the Union address, the next morning I picked up the telephone, called the Secretary of Energy and said, I am a supporter of this project. I want to move forward. We want to do everything we can to help move the project forward. So you can imagine how disappointed I was, not only disappointed but outraged after 5.5 years of research and spending literally tens of millions of dollars on this project that the Department of Energy and the administration decided to pull the plug on the project. We in this committee, this subcommittee, heard testimony from the representatives from the Department of Energy as to why the decision was made. They said basically that the reason that the project was going to be pulled and reassessed and realigned was because of cost, the escalating cost. We questioned that at the time, and you know, obviously today with the GAO findings, and we will get into that, and there are some quotes that I will put into the record very shortly. It was not cost. I said here, sitting in this subcommittee room, that I believed at the time that it was based on politics, that we had four sites that were the finalists, two in Texas and two in the state of Illinois. And when the alliance, the independent alliance that was appointed, not only for their expertise on this issue, but also to remove politics and to have independence from a political decision, but to base decisions on the science and what was best for the country, they examined all four sites and came up with a site in Mattoon, Illinois, and said that the Mattoon site was the best site. And it was then that the administration decided that, well, we're going to pull back on the project and pull the plug. So we know today that the GAO report says that it was not based upon cost. And, of course, they don't go into what the decision was based on, but I think that through the process of elimination, we know what it was based on. My goal is to get the project back on track. My goal is to not only move FutureGen and sequestration forward, but also to look at other clean coal technologies so that we, in fact, can begin to burn coal as cleanly and as efficiently as possible. And so, Mr. Chairman, again, I thank you for calling the hearing today. I look forward to hearing the testimony of our witnesses and look forward to moving this project forward.
Thank you, Mr. Costello, and thanks for your leadership on this very issue for so many years now. If there are other members who wish to submit opening statements, your statement will be added to the record at this point. And now I'd like to introduce our witnesses. Our first witness is Dr. Victor Durr. Mr. Durr is the Acting Assistant Secretary for the Department of Energy's Office of Fossil Energy. I want to briefly note, Mr. Durr, I appreciate very much your work with a company in Washington State that has developed leading-edge technology on compression of gases, which will be absolutely essential to success at some point if we move forward with this. And it's always nice when you hear from local constituents who say they've worked well with the government entity that's been very, very helpful, and thank you for your work on that. Mr. Mark Gaffigan is Director of the Natural Resources and Environmental Team at the U.S. Government Accountability Office, involved in preparing some of the reports that Mr. Costello alluded to. Dr. Robert Finley is the Director of the Energy and Earth Resources Center at the Illinois State Geological Survey. Dr. Finley, thank you for being here. Mr. Larry Monroe is a Senior Research Consultant at Southern Company. And Ms. Sarah Forbes is the Senior Associate of the Climate and Energy Program at the World Resource Institute. As our witnesses all know, you'll have 5 minutes for your spoken testimony. Then written testimony will be included in the record for the hearing. When each of you has concluded your combined testimony, we'll have questions from the panel. This is a bipartisan, friendly committee that asks tough questions, but in a way of trying to understand difficult and challenging issues. And with that, let's start with Dr. Durr. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate this opportunity to discuss the Department of Energy's advanced coal program with a keen focus on safe, effective, and affordable carbon capture and storage. Coal represents a tremendous and strategic national asset. With enough supply to take us well into the next century based on the current rates of consumption. And as we explore energy alternatives, coal used in an environmentally sustainable and responsible way will continue to play a critical role in the nation's energy strategy. Our focus must be, therefore, to develop deployable advanced technologies necessary to achieve near zero emissions from coal use, including carbon capture and storage, or CCS, not just in the United States, but in developing economies such as China and India, which will continue to rely on coal. Thus, CCS is an essential component of the global greenhouse gas mitigation strategy. DOE remains a leader in the development of advanced technologies that have helped reduce pollutant emissions and have increased power plant efficiency. These technological successes form a solid foundation upon which to build advances and innovations needed to meet the challenges of CO2 reductions. The advanced coal program is geared towards developing a portfolio of revolutionary technologies for CCS. To that end, and in partnership with the private sector, the program is focused on three important areas: technologies for affordable CO2 capture, especially back-end stack capture, establishing the scientific and technical basis for safe and effective storage of CO2, and substantially improving the efficiency and reliability of fossil energy systems. All three of these areas are important as we work to make CCS technologies deployable and cost-effective. We have a good start in this direction based on years of research and demonstration experience that have resulted in new concepts, including the conversion of coal into cleaner, versatile gases that can be used to generate power or produce fuels. Additionally, our research continues to explore emerging approaches to clean power generation that hold great promise for integration with coal-based or combined coal and biomass energy plants with CCS. To this end, we are working on CCS-enabling and transformational technologies, including advanced integrated gasification combined cycle, advanced hydrogen turbines, advanced materials for ultra-high efficiency plants, supersonic compression, and revolutionary concepts for CO2 capture. The success of our programs will ultimately be judged by the extent to which emerging, cost-effective technologies are deployed domestically and internationally. That is why DOE is implementing large-scale CCS demonstration efforts under the sequestration partnerships and the Clean Coal Power Initiative programs. And that is why we have taken a lead role in global partnerships like the Carbon Sequestration Leadership Forum, the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation, the International Energy Agency, and bilateral collaboration with countries such as Canada, India, and China, and other international initiatives. Mr. Chairman, today, nearly 75% of the coal power plants in the U.S. employ technologies with roots in DOE's program for advanced coal. With continued leadership and support from the administration and Congress, we can accelerate the development of new technologies to meet the requirements of a safe and secure energy future while reducing our carbon footprint. Again, Mr. Chairman, thank you for the opportunity to testify here today. And with that, I will welcome any questions that the committee may have.
Thank you, Dr. Durr. Mr. Gaffigan.
Chairman Baird, Ranking Member Inglis, members of the subcommittee, good morning. I'm pleased to be with you to discuss GAO's recent report on the Department of Energy's decision to restructure the FutureGen program. In 2003, DOE initiated FutureGen, a program to design, build, and operate a new coal-fired power plant that combined integrated gasification combined cycle, or IGCC, technology with carbon capture and storage. However, in 2008, DOE announced that it had decided to restructure FutureGen. GAO's report and the focus of my remarks address three questions regarding restructured FutureGen. One, how do the goals of the proposed restructured FutureGen program compare to the original program? Two, how does restructured FutureGen compare to DOE's other carbon capture and storage programs? And three, to what extent did DOE use sufficient information in its decision to restructure FutureGen? First, restructured FutureGen is very different from the original FutureGen program. While restructured FutureGen shares a common name and the overall goal of carbon capture and storage, it is fundamentally different from the original FutureGen program. Most significantly, the restructured program does not have an exclusive focus on the integration of integrated gasification combined cycle technology with carbon capture and storage. In addition, the restructured program does not have international partnerships that, in the original FutureGen program, were designed to improve the global advancement of carbon capture and storage. Finally, restructured FutureGen, unlike the original FutureGen, is not designed to serve as a living laboratory host facility for gaining broad industry acceptance of emerging technologies. It moves from a research and development focus to a commercial focus. In comparison to DOE's other carbon capture and storage programs, restructured FutureGen is most like round three of the Clean Coal Power Initiative. Most notably, both programs fund the commercial demonstration of carbon capture and storage at coal-fired power plants and require industry participants to bear at least 50% of the cost. Questions have been raised about how restructured FutureGen is different and the basis for the decision to restructure. In short, DOE's decision to restructure FutureGen was not well explained. DOE based its decision largely on its conclusion that costs for the original FutureGen had doubled and would escalate substantially. However, this conclusion is problematic because it was derived from a comparison of two cost estimates for the original FutureGen that were not comparable. It compared an initial estimate of approximately $950 million that was in constant dollars to a $1.8 billion estimate that was inflated through the year 2017. The focus on the difference in these very preliminary cost estimates as the reason to restructure FutureGen did not provide a sound basis for the decision. In contrast, DOE's Office of Fossil Energy had identified and analyzed other options for incremental cost-saving changes to the original program, such as reducing the CO2 capture requirement. However, we could not identify any comparable analysis that supported the decision to restructure FutureGen. By integrating IGCC and carbon capture and storage technology, DOE's original FutureGen program was intended to address significant technological, cost, and regulatory issues associated with the implementation of carbon capture and storage at a new plant. Alternatively, the restructured program leaves open the possibility of successfully applying carbon capture and storage technology to existing conventional pulverized coal-fired power plants, an important goal in its own right, since those plants account for almost all the coal-fired generating capacity in the United States and abroad. However, these plants will age, and demand for new sources of electricity will continue throughout the world. If coal is to be a fuel source of the future, and if CO2 emissions are to be controlled, developing new plants with improvements over today's conventional technology, such as that offered by IGCC, might also be an important goal. In weighing different goals to address the technological barriers associated with clean coal technology, it is also important to recognize that technology must be considered in conjunction with other barriers, most notably legal and regulatory uncertainties over carbon capture and storage, and the absence of a national strategy to control CO2 emissions that would provide the incentive for carbon capture and storage. As policymakers consider a path forward for clean coal technologies, including the original concept of FutureGen, a comprehensive analysis of the associated costs, benefits, and risks in this context is most important. Mr. Chairman, this completes my remarks. I have submitted a written statement and a copy of our report for your record.
Mr. Gaffigan, thank you. I want to take this opportunity to acknowledge that we've been joined by Chairman Gordon, Chairman of the full committee. Mr. Chairman, good to see you. Thanks for being here and for your request for this hearing as well. Also, Mr. Lujan, Dr. Lipinski, Ms. Edwards, Mr. Chandler, and Ms. Johnson are also here as well. Dr. Finley.
Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, I appreciate the opportunity to appear before you today and offer comments on carbon sequestration. Understanding the capacity to geologically sequester carbon dioxide produced as a byproduct of fossil fuel and biofuel use is an essential strategy to mitigate climate change related to the buildup of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. In 2007, the fourth assessment report of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change stated that, quote, carbon capture and storage in underground geological formations is a new technology with the potential to make an important contribution to mitigation by 2030. Technical, economic, and regulatory developments will affect actual contribution, unquote. At the Illinois State Geologic Survey, a division of the University of Illinois, we have been investigating carbon sequestration technology since 2003 as part of a U.S. Department of Energy regional carbon sequestration partnership. Our partnership, the Midwest Geological Sequestration Consortium, covers the Illinois Basin, a 60,000 square mile area that covers most of Illinois, southwestern Indiana, and western Kentucky. Our phase one characterization effort from 03 to 05 focused on compiling existing information. Our phase two validation effort currently underway involves multiple small-scale field pilot injection projects. Most importantly, we are now engaged in a critical phase three deployment effort, the Illinois Basin Decatur site, that will offer significant advances in carbon sequestration technology. After 2 years of site-specific development and planning at a site in Decatur, Illinois, we began on February 14th of this year the drilling of a 7,500-foot deep injection well that will receive 1,000 metric tons per day of CO2. As of this morning, we were drilling below 3,546 feet. This is the first phase three deployment well in the nation drilled as part of the DOE Regional Carbon Sequestration Partnership Program. We will be injecting over 3 years to meet an injection goal of 1 million metric tons. The permit is held by the Archer Daniels Midland Company, who has provided a half square mile site, logistical and engineering support, and will provide the CO2 as a product of their fuel ethanol production operations. We are confident that our work over the preceding 5 years in a year-long permitting process has resulted in an exceptional site for deployment phase testing. We have evaluated subsurface rock formations to define the capability of the reservoir to hold carbon dioxide, and we have defined multiple thick and competent reservoir seals, and we have demonstrated that there are no detectable faults and fractures that could serve as leakage pathways back to the surface. As a climate change mitigation strategy, the CO2 must remain in place and not leak back to the atmosphere, not contaminate potable groundwater, not affect surface biota, and not present a risk to human health and safety. This implies that we must do an excellent job of investigating the site. We have been carrying out environmental site monitoring since mid-2008. Before CO2 is ever injected, we will have more than a year of background data on groundwater chemistry, soil gas composition, plant stress assessed through color infrared aerial imagery, and atmospheric monitoring. We have 12 groundwater wells over the projected area of the subsurface plume and beyond. We will conduct geophysical studies that will show us within three dimensions where in the reservoir rock the CO2 is actually located. Most importantly, we will drill two additional 7,500-foot deep observation wells within the half-square mile area of the plume to calibrate these geophysical studies. These same wells serve as early warnings of any failure of our primary reservoir seal, an outcome with very low probability, but one that we nevertheless must demonstrate is not taking place. In conclusion, well-characterized sites with appropriate geology and careful monitoring can make a contribution and, in fact, must be part of a portfolio response to dealing with carbon dioxide emissions. In our regional partnership, we have a comprehensive research agenda that we believe will show that geological reservoir characterization or geological sequestration can be scaled up to be a safe and effective tool to combat climate change. Further, we are working to ensure that we share our results with research consortia around the world. A State Department World Resources Institute delegation of university researchers and corporate officials from China visited the Illinois Basin Decatur drill site 2 weeks ago, and we will make a reciprocal visit to China this coming June. Next week, I will present our partnership results at a meeting of the CO2 GeoNet European Research Network in Italy. While there is more to do in understanding the contributions that geological carbon sequestration can make at large scale in combating climate change, and more of these efforts will indeed take place as a result of the provisions of the Recovery and Reinvestment Act, I believe we are now moving at an accelerating pace to develop the technology and to share it around the world for our common benefit. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today about Southern Company's activities and plans for advanced coal technologies. Southern Company is a vertically integrated utility serving over 4 million customers in the Southeast. We are one of the largest electricity generators in the U.S., with some 70% of our energy coming from coal. I am a manager of engineering science and technology for Southern Company. I've been researching emissions control for coal power plants for over 25 years. Southern Company has a long history of cooperative work with the U.S. Department of Energy in development of technologies for the utility industry, including work on selective catalytic reduction for NOx emissions, flue gas scrubbers for sulfur oxide reduction, and mercury control technologies. As we face a future with policies that would limit emissions of carbon dioxide, we believe that coal must continue to play a role. Further, we believe that coal can and must play a role going forward with constraints on carbon emissions. To achieve this goal, technologies are currently being developed and adapted from other industries to capture and store emissions of CO2. However, the technologies are not yet ready for utilities to use commercially. They are not yet proven in power plant service, and as of today, they are too costly. This is the issue going forward. How can these technologies be proven and the cost reduced to make them commercially viable in the future? Southern Company is active in developing and demonstrating advanced coal technologies to meet this large challenge. First, I'll talk about our sequestration efforts. As a charter member of the Southeast Regional Carbon Sequestration Partnership, or CCARB, Southern Company has co-funded its activities and served as a host for a Phase 2 project injecting 3,000 tons of CO2 under one of our power plants in Southeast Mississippi. Working further with CCARB, we have a goal to scale up to a Phase 3 sequestration project of 100,000 tons of CO2 per year in similar geology at another one of our Gulf Coast power plants. This proposed project would feature a 25 megawatt scale CO2 capture plant that would be built to supply the CO2 for the sequestration demonstration. We have a further goal of developing an even larger scale up of this sequestration project that would feature injection of 1 million tons of CO2 per year for 5 years into the saline reservoirs of the Gulf Coast region. This project would include a 170 megawatt capture plant to supply the CO2. We submitted this proposed project in response to both the restructured FutureGen solicitation as well as CCPI round three. You'll notice that both of these two steps in sequestration scale-up are planned to also demonstrate CO2 capture at increasing scale on conventional coal power plants. For IGCC, we have asked the Mississippi Public Service Commission for approval to build a 600 megawatt IGCC power plant in eastern Mississippi using local lignite coal and designed for 50% CO2 capture. The CO2 would be sequestered in enhanced oil recovery operations in Mississippi oil fields. This new power plant would be partially funded with DOE funds from CCPI Round 2 and with investment tax credits authorized by the Energy Policy Act of 2005. Also in partnership with the DOE, Southern Company operates a research station in Wilsonville, Alabama, focused on developing advanced power generating technologies, including fundamental R&D for coal gasification. It is now moving its focus towards basic R&D and scale-up of technologies to capture CO2 from both conventional and IGCC coal plants. You can see that Southern Company is working on four areas we believe to be important: large-scale sequestration tests, CO2 capture from conventional coal plants, IGCC plants with carbon capture, and fundamental R&D for next-generation technologies. The issues to be overcome for widespread commercial deployment of carbon capture and sequestration are cost and timing. Both the pilot and industrial-scale trials of CO2 capture systems are much more expensive to build and operate than technologies for NOx, SO2, or mercury. The same high-cost penalties apply to full-scale power plants. To address high cost, we strongly think that a robust program of both technology development and a program of basic R&D are needed. Many of the nation's scientists are only now turning their attention to this field, and breakthroughs are possible. As for timing, the issue is the need to demonstrate to various stakeholders the effectiveness and safety of geological sequestration. As MIT recommends, we think that it is necessary for the nation to have multiple large-scale sequestration demonstrations of over 1 million tons of CO2 per year for at least 5 years. In order to have these results in adequate time, these demonstrations need to be started as soon as possible. Working in partnership with the U.S. DOE and others, Southern Company looks forward to working on the challenge of capturing CO2 from coal plants and demonstrating geological sequestration of CO2.
That concludes your testimony, Mr. Monroe.
Yes, I'm sorry. Thank you.
Ms. Forbes, you're recognized.
Good morning, and thank you for inviting me to testify today. I'm Sarah Forbes, and I lead the CO2 capture and storage work at the World Resources Institute. The World Resources Institute is a nonprofit, nonpartisan environmental think tank that goes beyond research to provide practical solutions to the world's most urgent environment and development challenges. The World Resources Institute has taken a lead in exploring the challenges and opportunities in the field of carbon capture and storage. We convened a 2-year stakeholder process, which resulted in the guidelines for carbon dioxide capture, transport, and storage. This report can serve as a benchmark for decision makers to use in evaluating potential projects. A key finding of these WRI guidelines was that even though additional research is needed in some areas, there is adequate technical understanding to safely conduct large-scale demonstrations. In fact, many of the remaining questions about CCS technology can only be answered by additional experience with the technology or policy interventions. Last July, the G8 set a goal of 20 CCS demonstrations globally by 2010. The U.S. Climate Action Partnership, of which WRI is a member, further recommends building at least 5 CCS projects in the United States by 2015. Achieving these goals in the right time frame is critical to deal with the looming climate challenge, but at the same time will require significant investment. There is a need for establishing a clear and robust international financing mechanism to fund these projects globally. To address this need, Congress should consider committing funding for public-private partnerships demonstrations in the U.S. and formally participate in international demonstration efforts. CCS demonstrations will require billions in research funding, with estimates at about $1 to $1.5 billion per project. Funding allocated in the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act of 2009 is significant, but unfortunately still falls short of what will be needed to commercialize CCS technology. A robust funding mechanism and a clear plan for collaboration among demonstration projects internationally is critical. It is time to evaluate the existing programs for international collaboration in the context of this emerging suite of global demonstration projects and to form formal partnerships with others pursuing demonstrations, the UK, the EU, China, Canada, and Australia. We also must enhance capacity for CCS demonstrations in China. China's coal-related carbon dioxide emissions are projected to be 51% of the world's total by 2030. Although China is actively deploying its non-carbon power sources, even rapid growth will not be enough to replace coal. Deployment of CCS in China may be the only way to globally make the needed reductions in carbon dioxide emissions. China is itself conducting research and quickly moving towards developing and demonstrating CCS technologies. In fact, the Chinese government was among the foreign governments who had pledged to commit funding to the original FutureGen project. Chinese companies and government institutions are also undertaking CCS research. For example, GreenGen, sponsored by China's five largest power companies, will soon build a 200-megawatt integrated gasification combined cycle power plant with CCS in nearby depleted oil fields before 2020. Both PetroChina, China's largest oil company, and Shenhua, its largest coal company, have pilot CCS programs with planned injections. It would be to the benefit of both the U.S. and China if there were more direct collaboration on CCS demonstrations. To address this need, Congress can commit funding for public-private partnership demonstrations projects in the U.S. and China that would be jointly funded and operated. This will require a serious funding commitment as well as programs that facilitate information sharing on regulatory and policy issues and support for U.S. businesses working internationally. Examples of programs that would help build increased capacity for CCS in China or other emerging economies include research exchange programs to bring students and faculty from China to see the projects operating in the United States and to study with leading researchers. An effective near-term approach would be to establish a research exchange program for visits to ongoing demonstrations in the United States, including the Department of Energy's Regional Carbon Sequestration Partnership Phase 3 projects. Exchange programs for environmental regulators and policy experts may also prove useful in resolving the legal, regulatory, and social challenges of deploying CCS technology. The Department of State, in collaboration with the Department of Energy, have implemented successful exchange programs in the past, which could be replicated with a focus on CCS technology and policy. Recently, as Dr. Finley mentioned, with support from the Department of State's Asia-Pacific Partnership, Tsinghua University in China has partnered with WRI on an effort to draft a set of guidelines for safe and effective CCS in China, like the report we did for the U.S. This work will be influential in developing Chinese CCS regulation and policy. In conclusion, globally, CCS has progressed to the point of demonstration readiness, and there is a race underway to see who will build the world's first large-scale integrated demonstration. Increased and coordinated international collaborations are essential. We need to specifically partner with emerging economies like China on demonstrating CCS technology through joint public-private partnerships. In these international collaborations, we must seek ways to build capacity and support efforts to develop global policies and environmental regulations that protect human health and ecosystems. This will include coordination and collaboration on demonstration that begins in the planning stages, together with projects that build capacity on regulatory and policy issues. Thank you.
The Chair thanks you, Ms. Forbes. Let me begin questioning. I think the chairman of the full committee, Chairman Gordon, stepped out. When he returns, he has questions, I know. But let me begin, Mr. Gaffigan, with your testimony. And I think you touched on this, but I'd like you to elaborate. In your analysis of the restructured FutureGen, did you find that the cost escalation used by the Department of Energy to justify the restructuring, scrapping the initial FutureGen plan to go with a restructured program valid?
We asked over and over for analysis behind the cost estimate. We found it was a pretty much a straightforward 5.2% escalation factor. We pointed out that there are others that point out that you're not going to see that sustained growth in escalation factors. And in fact, EIA had pointed that out, that even at the time, though, we were looking at a lot of cost escalations. Look at us today in terms of the concerns about whether there is going to be that cost escalation and whether there is going to be jobs for people because of the economy slowing down. So that was the point made. And that in looking at the total number, you know, very well you could see cost escalation. But what we did not see is any in-depth analysis. And we didn't see a good explanation for why they talked about a doubling of cost when, in fact, it was comparing some constant dollars to escalated dollars.
And that's a very important point. In one of our subcommittee hearings concerning this issue and the cost escalation and the reason used by the Department of Energy to scrap the project, without question, the cost did increase. But when you look at other projects around the country and look at the cost of building materials, look at the cost of labor, the increases from the time that the project was planned and the projected cost were arrived at, they were no different than any other project of that size. Would that be something that you would agree with?
I would agree with that. And the other thing I would point out is that the Alliance was working on a revised cost estimate based on a specific site. And it's important to point out these estimates were very preliminary, but they had targeted to do a cost estimate in June of 08. The question we raised is what was the cost in sort of not waiting to see what that cost estimate would have been. It would have been a newer estimate. It would have reflected the site-specific type activities, and that was never, it seemed like it was never considered.
And of course, since the decision was made to pull the plug on the initial project as planned, the fact that we have lost time now, that has increased the cost of whatever project that we move forward with. If it's a scaled-back version or if we would go back to the original proposal, we've increased cost because we have lost time, and would you agree with that?
Well, we may, we didn't look at a specific cost estimates relative to that, but I would say there's definitely an opportunity cost of not going forward. That being said, I think it is important to recognize that cost escalation does happen. In the Department of Energy, there's a history of cost escalation. In fact, if cost escalation was the criteria for going forward with projects at the Department of Energy, FutureGen wouldn't be the only one that had been canceled.
I thank you. Dr. Durr, let me ask, at the time when the administration back then made the decision to pull the plug, one of the things that they were attempting to do was to negotiate with the Alliance on cost share, that they wanted the private sector and the Alliance to come up with a higher percentage of the cost of the project than originally proposed. We were told by the Alliance that that was negotiable, that they in fact would sit down and discuss with the Department of Energy a higher cost share. Is that your understanding?
My understanding was that such discussions were taking place, and it's my understanding also that the department did not feel that at that time that these were moving forward in a fruitful, sustainable manner, as I was told.
Well, just for the record, the Alliance told us just the opposite, that they in fact were willing to negotiate, were willing to increase their cost share, but the administration and the Department of Energy at the time had basically made the decision that they were going to scrap, pull the plug on the initial concept, and were not earnest in trying to negotiate a higher cost share, but the Alliance was willing to increase their cost share. One other question, and then I'll ask Chairman Gordon if he has questions. Mr. Finley, what important lessons have been learned from the small-scale field project that the injection project initiated by the consortium and the validation of efforts?
Well, I believe what we've been able to show is that the study that was based on existing data from 2003 to 2005 during our phase one effort, that data were largely validated in the sense that the thickness of the receiving reservoir over a wide area of the Illinois Basin is over 1,000 feet thick. That both includes our test sites and it includes the FutureGen site at Decatur. And that the reservoir seal, the geology of that seal looks competent over a wide area of literally thousands of square miles. So basically what we have validated in our efforts is that the geological characteristics of the area of our regional sequestration partnership, and because that is coincident with the Mattoon FutureGen site, that geology is very favorable for geological carbon sequestration.
Thank you. The chair now recognizes the chairman of the full committee, Chairman Gordon.
Thank you, Mr. Costello. I know this is an issue that's close to your heart, and this is a very important issue and a very good panel, and I thank you all for being here. Mr. Gaffigan, your report clearly points out that DOE was comparing two cost estimates that were just not comparable, which, unfortunately, we've run into this in other types of R&D projects, which makes it difficult to go back to the public and say we need more money when these things aren't clear. What should the department do, and what should Congress require them to do to improve this situation?
Well, contracting in the government and DOE in particular has been an area that we have focused in. In fact, contracting at DOE is considered a high risk for us, and particularly in the weapons side of the House. And I think we have identified certain things that are important in terms of controlling costs and managing projects. And it sort of starts at the top, a commitment to schedule, having the right people involved there in contracting the resources, and the commitment to measure progress along the way for these projects. And we have found, for example, in the Office of Science that they've made great progress in this area and overcome some of these issues associated with major projects.
So you're trying to make me feel better that when we do this again?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, look, these things are high risk. I mean, even FutureGen is a high risk issue, and that's, you know, that's why the government is sort of stepping in to try and help with in partnership with the private sector to share that risk.
Well, that's the next point I want to get to. Is this project being, or this type of project being done anywhere else now?
Not that I'm aware of.
And as we see climate change legislation looming over us, would this not be an important tool in our box to move forward if we're going to continue, which I think we have to, with coal-fired plants?
I think absolutely. It's one of the issues addressing the technology barriers. I would also point out that there are other issues that need to be considered in concert with that, including the regulatory and legal framework with carbon capture and storage, as well as what are we going to do about carbon, and are we going to be able to send a signal to the market? Because ultimately, we could put all the money we want into these projects, and we testified last year that, you know, the government has spent over $60 billion or close to $60 billion over the last 30 years in advanced energy technologies, yet we're still heavily reliant on conventional fossil fuels. Yeah. And it can't just be the government spending money. It's got to consider the context of the private market.
And Ms. Forbes, if I could, I'll pontificate a little bit on a pet project of mine. These are going to be very expensive programs, carbon capture and sequestration. And these are times of limited resources. It seems to me that we should follow up on a proposal that was made at the G8, I guess it was last year, to do an international type of cooperation with this, particularly in this area, and of energy in general. I sort of see it as them that has it and them that don't, and we're in the don't category. And that, particularly with coal, where we have so much coal in contrast to oil and gas, that we should look at some type of an international cooperation in terms of sharing both the intellectual part of it as well as the financial part. Maybe take different geological formations that once one country might have, we take a couple here, someplace else there. Is that reasonable, and could you elaborate on that some for me? Pros and cons?
Yes, I think that we have some existing frameworks for international collaboration on this subject. One of the things that's happening right now is that the request of the G8, the International Energy Agency, is developing an international roadmap for CCS.
Good.
I think that document is set to be released in October. It will be significant, and it will outline the global suite of demonstrations that are in various stages of planning. But yes, I agree with you. We need to work globally.
Now, will it help lead to any kind of a contract or a treaty where there will be coordination and cooperation in this effort? Or is it just giving you a menu of what's going on now?
The roadmap will be a document. It will outline how to get to the 20 demonstrations by 2020. I think that beyond the roadmap, we need to revisit some of the existing bilateral agreements with individual countries and form new partnerships where warranted to collaborate specifically on demonstrations.
And is G8 the best vehicle for that, or is there any other vehicle that you would recommend?
I'm not sure, but I'd be happy to get back to you on that.
I mean, it seems to me that at the end of the day, and again, this will be expensive, and it's going to have to be head of state to head of state making the agreement and the commitments, because it will have budgetary impacts. But then you're going to have, again, some vehicle to coordinate that. So I would appreciate if you would give me any of your thoughts.
Thank you. We'll do the analysis.
And thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Chairman Gordon. Just for the record, let me state, as Ms. Forbes has indicated, that the original concept and project that was proposed had a lot of international interest in it, from China, India, Australia, a number of other countries who pledged money and were willing to cooperate and work with us When it comes back to my turn for a second round of questioning, I want to talk a little bit about that and how the fact that the previous administration, when they pulled the plug on this, how our international partners were notified and if, in fact, we can bring them back to the table and have them work with the alliance. The chair now recognizes the ranking member of the subcommittee, Mr. Inglis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Monroe, I think you had the key word here that I've heard, and that is scalability. So I'm wondering, the projects that Southern Company is doing, which are very exciting, are those, what percentage of the CO2 emissions are involved there? You have any idea? There are big numbers in terms of sequestration there, but in terms of the percentage of the outflow, what would it be? You have any idea?
They're fairly modest, with the exception of the new integrated gasification combined cycle plant I mentioned in Mississippi, which would be 50% of 600 megawatts. So that's significant. The other projects are really taking a stair-step approach. Mm-hmm. In utility business and with our cooperation with the Department of Energy, we found that if we try to take too big of a step, we make too many mistakes. So we try to sort of step at a factor of 10 almost. So right. We're talking sequestration or size. So the two projects I mentioned, the first one at 25 megawatts, the second one 170 megawatts, are fairly small by power plant standards.
Right.
So our largest power plant is 3,600 megawatts. So that's roughly only about 5% at the largest scale we're talking there. Some of the actual plants that we would be looking at would be anywhere from 30% to, say, 10% of the total plant output at the largest scale that I mentioned on the existing plants.
Gotcha. So that's... And I'm also excited for parochial reasons to hear that you're interested in the IGCC because General Electric is in Greenville, South Carolina, and that may help business there and other places, and I'm very excited about that. And it's an exciting technology. And so now I'm going to ask a question against my own interest. Why would Southern Company be interested in doing that? It's more expensive than sort of a conventional coal fire plant, right? Is it just good citizens or?
We really see the future as being one that we expect limitations on carbon emissions, particularly for our sector.
Right.
So to try to sort of smooth that transition, to try to service our customers as reliably as possible, we are spending more money for that generation than it would be the alternative.
Yeah.
So,
do you have any trouble with PSCs, public service commissions, getting that approval? Or I hope not, but something tells me you might. And this is one of the issues that Duke is encountering in South Carolina. You know, you deal with nuclear, it's a great way to make electricity, but getting it through the PSC can be really difficult because it sure is cheap to make coal-fired electricity.
Yes. On the project in Mississippi, we have asked. In mid-January, we had submitted the request for their consideration for approval of that. We do have a little bit of help there in the fact that our CO2 will actually be, we can sell that to oil producers in Mississippi, and so that we're not paying to do a geological sequestration test, but actually selling it. It'll eventually be sequestered in those enhanced oil recovery operations, but that's a benefit there. So
yeah, makes the economics work a little bit better for you there.
But
yeah.
But still not compelling. So that the Public Service Commission is still one that is very much up in the air for that plant.
Gotcha. Yeah, interesting. Because that's with of course those economics would change. I take it if there's a price attached to carbon, either through what I'd like to see, which is revenue neutral carbon tax, or cap and trade. Either one would cause those economics to change, I suppose. And the Public Service Commission would be more easily convinced, I suppose. Or
yes, we do see that changing. Our fear and the reason we're pushing so strongly now for technology is that we're afraid of a dash to gas, so to speak. So if you run the numbers right now, we need more electricity generation. Natural gas is the one that falls out when you put all the numbers down on the paper. So we think that we have to do this sort of work, both sort of at scale and go back to universities, national labs, in cooperation with utility companies to see if we can find new technologies to make that cost differential so that coal becomes one choice that's still valid in the future.
Well, I'm very excited to hear about your Southern Company's commitment to this kind of research. I had an unfortunate meeting one time with a utility, to go nameless, that told me they didn't have an R&D department. They seemed sort of proud of it, that they didn't have one. And I guess it's because they didn't want to say to the PSC that we've got all this in our cost structure. But hats off to you all for wanting to pursue the answer and somehow getting the PSCs in various places to agree that's okay to pay all those people. So
it's part of our personality, and we take a lot of pride in the fact we have a very active, very aggressive, some of the international cooperation that was mentioned earlier on some of these projects. We've talked to people in Sweden, in Denmark, in Germany, Japan, and England about participating in our projects and sharing information there. So the benefit of having a research staff and active organization is you can reach out and find these technologies.
That's great. Thank you.
Chair, thanks the gentleman, and now recognizes the gentleman from New Mexico, Mr. Luan.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much, and thank you for putting this hearing together. Dr. Durr, you opened up your remarks, and you made a reference to being responsible and sustainable. Can you refresh my memory on what you said in that context?
I think the context was in the use of coal being environmentally sustainable and responsible in terms of its use, and that relates to the emissions and the carbon aspects of it.
And Dr. Durr, would you agree that as we're talking about the future generation of energy in the United States as well as around the world, that that's really a concept that we should adopt and embrace as we're moving forward with generation?
I believe so.
Is there anyone on the panel that doesn't agree that that's where we need to move energy generation when we're talking about being responsible and sustainable with the way we're going to be generating power today and tomorrow? That's great to hear. As we're discussing the future of generation and some of the improvements that are being invested in and made by utilities across the country and some of the awareness that's being generated around the world, Mr. Monroe, what's one of the biggest reasons that your company has moved forward with a commitment in research and development? Is it to be more responsible, the way that we're generating power today, to do things better than the way we've been doing them in the past, maybe?
It's sort of a balanced view. We've always tried to balance sort of the cost of electricity we supply to our customers with the environmental footprint that our generating plants have, and so as we become more aware of how our emissions may affect the climate, we've become much more worried about that, and so have moved forward with research trying to anticipate. And what we don't like is to suddenly have very steep changes in the way we would generate electricity. And so we view through research a way to sort of smooth out that path, so when we see a future transition coming, we start actively working on it.
And so with that being said, would you agree that we can do things better than the way that we're doing them today when it comes to the way that we're generating power from the various resources that we have, renewables included?
Yes, we can, but again, in this concept of balance between affordability of electricity and what we do environmental footprint, that's our main concern is sort of doing a good job for our customers to bring them affordable electricity. In your area of the country, renewables are much more accessible than they are in the Southeast, so that we have been working quite hard to try to find out how to do significant renewables. We don't have much wind in the Southeast. The solar energy appears to be there, but because of haze and humidity, it's not that effective in the Deep South. And so the one area that we look at the closest is biomass. And so we're in the process as we speak of converting one of our older coal plants, taking the fuel away as coal and adding it as wood from the forest of Georgia. This is in Albany, Georgia, a small plant, about 100 megawatts. And so we're moving in that renewable direction as well. We're also investigating nuclear power as a way to minimize that environmental footprint. But as I mentioned in my testimony, we're still a very large coal-based sort of system. And so we have been have started to put lots of resources into looking at, is there a way to lessen the footprint of these coal plants?
Thank you. And Dr. Durr, when we're talking about the future of generation of electricity, the way that it's moving forward, when we talk about polarized coal and the way that it's been generated in the past, and the concern about moving forward and the support, even though the project didn't move forward under the previous administration, with this whole concept of clean coal. I noticed that in your testimony that you talk about advanced coal, but the only mention of clean coal is in the description of some of the agencies that are working with you. Is there a reason for that you chose to use the word advanced as opposed to clean?
Yes, I think advanced coal implies that we are working on technologies that make it clean, which would include the capture of the carbon associated with it. And in advanced coal, we're trying to move that that yardstick forward to looking at technologies that are affordable to allow us to reach those goals of reducing those emissions, including carbon.
And one last question, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Durr, as we're moving forward with the way that we're looking at generation today, should future proposed coal generating facilities be really maybe put on hold or considered to scale back until we're able to move forward and develop these important technologies that there's been such a serious investment in?
I think because of the projections and the increase in the electricity demand and the needs for this country and around the world, I think we still have to retain that option to move forward while we work on the research to reduce that cost and its performance. We need to move forward in a parallel approach for the same reasons that Mr. Monroe advocated, that we need experience in looking at some of these coal plants that we can put carbon capture and storage onto, even though they are expensive now, that experience that we have from doing that, our lessons learned to allow us to do things a little more efficiently while we bring down those costs and wait for these new technologies that can be put on and replace these technologies here. So I think the overall future demand would probably not allow us to maybe put a hold on coal, but we should do it, as we say, in an advanced, clean manner, including the carbon capture.
Thank you, Chair.
Chair, thanks. The gentleman and now recognizes the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Diaz-Balard. Thank you. The chair now recognizes the gentlelady, Ms. Edwards.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the panel. I'm just curious. I just want to be really clear about that. Can you just raise your hand if you are at all skeptical about CCS as a future technology? Can you please describe your skepticism, and especially as it relates to reaching peak greenhouse gas emissions in 2015?
We have to demonstrate it. I think the research has been really promising, but we haven't done it at scale. And I think one of the things that we learned in developing the guidelines was we have to balance our confidence about the fact that we think this technology is going to work and that it's an important part of a portfolio of solutions for climate change with the fact that there are still questions that we don't know and questions that can't be answered until we move forward with the demonstrations.
Can I just ask, just in terms of the amount of the expenditure over the lifetime of this particular investigatory stage that could be spent not just in renewables but in existing coal plants? And making those more efficient because they exist. It seems to me a lot of the discussion is about building new plants, and in this country and around the globe, we have old plants that are inexistent, that are inefficient, that are producing CO2 emissions at tremendous scale, and yet we're investing in a technology that may or may not work in 20 or 30 years.
The technology for carbon capture and storage must include approaches that apply to the existing fleet to post-combustion capture. The original FutureGen was an integrated gasification combined cycle, would be a new plant, but CCS broadly should explore opportunities to deal with the existing fleet as well as the plants that they're building in China and India right now.
And is it your view that the current plan, the evolved plan from the canceled FutureGen project focuses on existing plants?
I would defer that question to Mr. Gadkin. I believe it allows for existing plants for post-combustion, and I think that's one of the pros of the new approach. But I also think that there was a substantial investment in the original FutureGen that shouldn't be ignored. I think there are advantages to both approaches.
Mr. Gaffigan?
It allows for both.
Is that what's happening?
We don't know. DOE has gotten a small number of proposals for the restructured FutureGen. They've asked for more information from some of the solicitors, and right now it's in the negotiation stage. I don't know if Dr. Durr has an update, but right now the main difference to think about is that, you know, the original FutureGen was an exclusive focus on IGCC, and whether that's good or bad, I'll let the policymakers decide. It was an exclusive focus. It was considered one of the tools going forward. And the difference now, and even in the initial proposal for restructured FutureGen, it talked about an IGCC focus. But when the actual bid went out for proposals, it also allowed for other, and to include existing.
And how many existing coal plants do we have in the country? Anybody know?
Somewhere about
over 600.
Over 600 in this country, I guess, according to Dr. Durr. It depends on the size of some of these plants. Some are very small. Mm-hmm. We've heard of figures about 1,100, but that might include some real small plants.
Okay. And then, Mr. Gaffigan, again, in terms of the cost, I mean, I understand, the math error, which is unbelievable. And I mean, we should, send everybody to second grade. But I wonder, even in the best circumstances, would a 39% overrun have been acceptable over the life of a project?
Potentially. Again, as these are very preliminary cost estimates, and you're going to see some cost escalation, especially with state-of-the-art, new R&D type things. Whether 39% is tolerable or not, that depends on how it's managed throughout. What I would point out, again, is that there was a new cost estimate being prepared that probably would have given better information was more site-specific.
But in fact, though, if GAO were evaluating a project, whether it's in this department or another department, with a 39% cost overrun, you would have raised some questions about that, wouldn't you?
Well, we would have, sure, depending on how it was handled. I mean, they could have decided that they wanted to pursue a different scope, and then it was agreed upon that would cause the cost increase. It's whether it's managed or not, I think, is key. I mean, there are some projects in DOE, we just recently testified more on the weapons side. I think we looked at 8 out of 10 projects, and combined, there was over $14 billion in cost overrun.
Yeah, I know, and I think a lot of us have some concerns about that. Out of curiosity, Mr. Durr, I wonder if you could talk to me about the ability to rely on a projected operation or commercialization, say, in 20 years with investments in the revamped FutureGen, and how that relates to what we might take that same money and spend on other kinds of technology that would serve to reduce carbon emissions in the next 20 to 30 years.
I think given the magnitude and the reliance that not only the United States has on coal for power generation, but the rest of the world, I think it's important for us to work on solving that problem. There are technology, you're right in saying that we have an existing fleet, and Mr. Gavin is talking about the fact that the FutureGen project looked at new construction. Our program is more comprehensive than just looking at the gasification. It addresses the capture or the stack capture of carbon emissions from the existing fleet. It is a challenging and daunting task. The Secretary is committed to focusing on that as an additional area of emphasis as well. So I think that the problem should be worked on now.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
The Chair thanks the gentlelady and now recognizes the gentlelady from Texas, Ms. Johnson.
Thank you very much. I know that this was a different administration, but why was the project canceled last year or in the last 2 years?
Well, we were asked that question, and we asked over and over again, and we were told that it was because of the cost doubling. And we were pointed to the Secretary. It was his decision, and we're pointed to his testimony on the matter. So the bottom line, for the most part, the answer was because of the cost had doubled.
And you're ready now to look at it again for less cost or more?
Well, we, I guess that would be up to the current administration what they want to look at. Our point was that there were very preliminary cost estimates, and to throw out this doubling was really not was not accurate in terms of the potential cost increases. I don't know if Dr. Durr wants to add to that.
It's my understanding that the secretary will is planning to meet with the FutureGen Alliance to restart discussions on this particular project.
If the general lady will yield to the chair.
Yes.
Reason, as you'll recall, given by the administration for canceling the project was the escalating cost. And the administration indicated they didn't anticipate the increase in costs. They were using, as Mr. Gaffigan, I won't put words in your mouth, if you'll explain the numbers that they were using in terms of real dollars versus
imaginary.
Well, roughly, they were, I mean, this is ballpark, they were talking originally about a $1 billion project. They compared that to an escalated cost through 2017 of $1.8 billion. If you took those dollars and took them back to the same year's dollars, you would be talking about roughly about $1.3 billion. So the actual increase that the Alliance brought forward was about $300 million. And I'll also point out that that was discussed in March of 07 when they signed the latest cooperative agreement, or the next part of it, the continuation. It was only after that then that they started questioning this cost, and then the concerns about the doubling of costs started to be talked about.
And I would point out to the general lady that the Chairman Gordon, Chairman Baird, and myself and Mr. Lipinski asked the GAO to do a report and to look at the reason, was it in fact cost, and I think the GAO report, which is being released today, will indicate that it was not cost and was not justified stopping the project because of cost. And they looked at and analyzed the numbers and said that the administration was not using accurate figures. And I pointed out earlier, too, in an earlier subcommittee hearing, as you'll recall, that if you look at other projects in the same time frame that increased in cost, it was as a result of the increase in cost of material, building materials, concrete, other materials, as well as labor. So I thank the general lady for yielding.
Thank you very much. That's the end of my question.
Chair now recognizes Mr. Tonko.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you for this important hearing, and I thank the panel also. Dr. Durr, the issue of infrastructure for carbon capture and storage is one that comes up often, and I'm wondering where the department might be in terms of analysis that are done or any efforts being made on a process to address pipelines that might be required to deal with the point of emission onto the storage area. And if there is a plan to do that in a national framework.
The pipeline infrastructure that would be associated with carbon capture and storage, depending on how far the transport of the CO2 goes, could be considerable. The jurisdiction, as I understand it, relative to pipeline infrastructure and regulations does not rest with the Department of Energy. It rests, as I believe, with the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission and, to a large degree, with the states.
Is anyone else on the panel able to offer any thoughts on that as to how that infrastructure may be addressed in your particular cases?
I'll just offer one thought, and I think it goes to Ms. Edwards' early comment about, you know, are you skeptical about CCS? I don't know if I'm skeptical. What I would say is there are a great deal of uncertainties, and this is definitely one of them, the infrastructure to move the CO2 around at the scale that Ms. Forbes is referring to. I mean, I think we know we can do carbon capture and storage. Can we do it at this huge scale and put all this stuff, move it around, put it into ground, and hope that it stays there?
Mm-hmm. And as in terms of another bit of infrastructure with the water demands that may be increased and enhanced, Are there efforts being made to review just what the water issue might be for some of these facilities?
Yeah, I think there was a panel yesterday that talked about water and energy nexus, and the discussion that centered about carbon capture and storage did indicate that there would be an increase in water usage, and given the current capture technology that exists today. And one of the things that the Department of Energy is looking at are advanced capture systems that would reduce the consumption of the water, as well as the energy penalties associated with it, as well as the cost of the components.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. You know, as in my last station before coming here, I was at NYSERDA in New York with the Energy Research and Development Authority. And I know there are those who are looking for sequestration facilities, and there are a lot of concerns about the price, obviously, and then a number of the dynamics that need to be addressed in order to provide for a safe and effective outcome. But I thank you all for your input.
Chair, thanks to the gentleman, and now recognizes the ranking member for his another round of questioning.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We mentioned breakthroughs earlier and the hope for breakthroughs. Help me figure out where those are likely to come from. Anybody want to take a shot at where the what kind of technologies, what kind of processes might give us these breakthroughs?
I'll start. The technologies we would use today, and it really doesn't matter whether it's IGCC or a conventional coal plant, really are adapted from the chemical and petroleum industries. They use a water-based chemical, a basic chemical, to capture the acidic CO2. Part of the energy penalty is, and mentioned the water usage, that is part of the water usage, but to get so we capture the CO2 with this water mixture, we have to take it somewhere else to get the CO2 to turn loose. We reuse the chemical, and it's really the heat to make that CO2 turn loose that makes it so expensive on the capture side. It's the energy to do that. That's the biggest piece we look at for benefits there. We still have to compress the CO2, so there's still a significant sort of energy to make it a high enough pressure to push down a pipeline or even push underground. So we're really looking at how to take CO2 out of these streams. So I'll mention some that are interesting to us. Some are solid chemicals that could capture the CO2. Then we wouldn't have to heat up this 70% water and waste all of that heat.
Right.
Membranes to sort of, on a molecular level, filter the CO2 and get the CO2 to come through this filter, but the rest of the gas not come through, are some of the most promising ones right now.
Yeah. Anybody else want to?
I just want to weigh one thing in terms of the technology. And obviously, GEO doesn't bring the technology to the table, and we were really impressed with the wide range of expertise that's out there, both in the private sector and at DOE. But what I would say, what is going to sort of bring the breakthroughs, is the incentive to do so and to let that private sector get out there and do those things. And I think one of the signals could be some regulatory certainty about what we're going to do about carbon that would bring that private sector to achieve some of these breakthroughs.
Yeah. Interesting, yeah.
The Department of Energy and its national laboratories and universities are actually working very hard on this particular issue about the energy penalty and the cost associated with these revolutionary ideas and, as the Secretary mentioned, these transformational, game-changing technologies. Some of the ideas out there right now include clathrate capture of the CO2, which basically is a it locks it into a structure, and then you can re-release it. There are ideas known as ionic liquids, where it's basically a filter where the CO2 goes into these spaces. And again, with just very mild energy and pressure differentials, you can re-release that as well. So the key here is capital cost, energy penalty reduction, and making sure that those technologies integrate well with the power plant or any other type of industrial source.
I'd like to add one more comment. I think it's very important to look at some of the soft ideas, though not technologically, not hard technologies we need to relate to. We need to understand who owns the pore space. We need to understand a regulatory framework in which this will take place. We need to understand how do we go about leasing the subsurface rights in the land areas for large-scale demonstrations. And not only that, we need to look beyond We're now at the deployment phase for testing. What happens, for example, in a given geological region if, for example, you have 20 of these projects putting away 5 million tons a year per project in the subsurface? What does that do on a large regional scale to aquifers, the subsurface environment, and so forth? Because ultimately, the scale of this to be totally effective could become quite large. And the issue of public acceptance and the framework in which this takes place legally and from a regulatory framework must also be looked at.
Yeah. Any idea whether China has favorable geological formations for sequestration? Anybody know that?
There have been some preliminary studies. It looks like there are some oil and gas fields in China that are promising that would be potential opportunities. And also some of the U.S. geologists have been going over to China and working with the Chinese, specifically with Shenhua, to look and see, that's the biggest coal company in China, to see, associated with one of their big coal-to-liquid plants, they're doing a test injection. And they've been doing real characterization of the geology to determine how it's going to work. It's potentially promising.
Right, very helpful. Yeah, Mr. Gaffigan, I think, has a key thing there. It's so exciting to hear is the concept of the private sector having an incentive to do this. Because, you know, what Microsoft and Apple did for the PC and the Internet, the private sector properly incentivized by a price signal being attached to this negative externality and having that attached to the product, would drive innovation faster than anything we could do from this science committee or anything we could do in Congress.
Absolutely. And it goes to your point about the PSCs. They're not going to improve things until they see it in their best interest.
Right.
Most of the folks out there are in a wait and see.
Right.
They're wait and see.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Chair, thanks you. And Dr. Finley, in your testimony, you talk about the importance of characterization, and I wonder if you would talk about how long it takes to conduct robust site characterization and also the cost associated as well.
I think if you were to start at ground zero from, say, in a region for which you know such project currently existed, you would probably need at least a year to put together a full-scale geologic framework based on existing data. At that point in time, I think you would be ready to run geophysics and to perhaps drill a preliminary well, a stratigraphic test. Those data that carrying that out and aligning that data would take you at least another year. So I would think a two-year process at a minimum from the get-go to at least have a understanding of whether a site would be suitable. I think the cost of doing that at a minimal framework could be in the range of let's say $15 to $20 million.
And do you know how much the state of Illinois spent on looking at the sites in the state of Illinois in order to make their case to the alliance?
I believe state funds, certainly several million. I don't know the exact number, but I know that almost $1 million was spent in state of Illinois funds since the project was canceled alone to demonstrate the continued suitability of the site and the contribution that the state made to the alliance purchase of the 400-plus acres for the site.
Well, and I think that's one of the points of that I made earlier about being outraged and pulling the plug. This was a competitive process, and the state of Illinois and other states as well spent millions of dollars in the competition. So. I wanted to point that out. If you start from ground zero, you're talking about a minimum of a two-year process, and at least in Illinois, my knowledge of the site that the alliance selected, the state of Illinois spent well over $10 million and probably closer to $20 million in this competition. Dr. Durr, let me ask you, and I don't know if you're in a position to tell us, but to your knowledge, how is the department planning on spending the funds available under the Recovery and Reinvestment Act?
The guidelines that were put into the legislation put monies into certain pots of that $3.4 billion. There is a $800 million that is going to go to augmenting the CCPI round three, which includes carbon capture in it. There was another $1.52 billion in there for looking at industrial carbon capture and storage projects, a $50 million associated with the characterizing additional sites, $20 million for some research and training on the geological sequestration. The remaining $1 billion is something that the Secretary and the Department is still making decisions on, and we'll probably come to that shortly.
Would you, in your opinion, being involved in the FutureGen program within the Department for the last five-plus years, would you classify the FutureGen project as a shovel-ready or a near-shovel-ready project as far as sequestration is concerned?
I would probably characterize it as something that would be near shovel ready. We have to probably finish up some work that was not finished up in the preliminary design phase that were specific to that particular site, do some more of the characterization that Dr. Finley talked about specific to that, and finish up the design. And after doing something like that, it would be pretty much ready to go forward.
Is there any sequestration project that you're aware of that is more advanced or ready more so than FutureGen?
Not to my knowledge at the current time, sir.
Last question, Dr. Durr. Can you share with us some of your thoughts or concerns about the restructured FutureGen program?
I think when you look at it on balance, the restructured FutureGen program sort of addresses a different issue than the original FutureGen. The original FutureGen as an advanced platform for testing these new technologies was to push the stick forward, if you will, on the technology for gasification. In the restructured FutureGen, it focuses on putting technologies that we have today onto existing commercial platforms and to gain that kind of experience early on. And that in itself also has value. So it's a judgment call as to, you know, which way do we go on something like this.
My final question of you, Dr. Durr, and I would ask Ms. Forbes or any of the other witnesses to comment. We talked about international partners that were very interested and committed, actually, to participating in the FutureGen project, China, India, a number of other countries. My understanding is the way that some of these countries found out that we were pulling the plug is they read it in media reports. They were not given advance notice. Two, do you feel that the interest will still be there, that we can still bring these other countries and international interest into this project?
I think the Secretary Chu has indicated that it makes sense for countries to collaborate and coordinate its portfolio of projects. And I know that he's been taking a very proactive position in contacting his counterparts around the world. And I have all the confidence in the world that he will be successful in doing that.
Ms. Forbes, would you want to comment?
Yeah, based on our experience in working with some of China's leading CCS experts, I would say there is definitely interest in collaboration on demonstrations and also on issues that are associated with policy and regulatory and really building capacity. They'd like to work together.
Any other comments from?
Just a quick note that, you know, I think the international partners were putting up money towards this, up toward 8%, and one of the considerations in looking at options for a cost escalation was to look for whether they would want to contribute more. And as I understand it, we still have the money from India, so we need to make a decision there one way or the other.
Dr. Finley.
I think your point is very well taken. It's all one atmosphere, and I think to the extent that we provide technology in a collaborative manner with international partners around the world, I think it's absolutely essential. I think in some cases these partners, for example, are not even totally aware of the level of effort that the U.S. is making. That was the case when the Chinese delegation visited our site in Decatur. They were very, very excited to see an actual well going down into which we would put 1 million tons of CO2.
The chair thanks you and now recognizes the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Diaz-Balart.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll be brief. GAO has said that incentives would really come from regulatory certainty, and that a price on carbon would spur technological innovation in effect. Are we seeing those technological innovations coming from Europe as far as CCS is concerned? And how much and how dramatic and how aggressive?
Right. The international expertise is not my bailiwick, but I will say that from what we have seen, you know, they're struggling with their system to figure out, is it working? And I think we'll probably go through some of the same things. My point in general is that in this country, folks are looking for that regulatory certainty. Some folks, like Mr. Monroe's company, are trying to hedge a little bit and anticipate what might happen. I'm not as familiar with the international activities in Europe. I don't know if Ms. Forbes might be.
Three things that I'd like to mention going on in Europe. First, the European Union has finalized a directive for geologic sequestration, which includes the environmental regulatory structure for how to do CCS responsibly. There's also been an effort, and this is in my written testimony as well, to commit funding for CCS demonstrations, a network of 10 to 12 throughout Europe through proceeds from the European trading scheme. Additionally, some of the European utilities have been really proactive. It's my understanding that one of the European utilities actually has pilot scale tests of each of the commercial capture options that are out there today, and they're currently operating and basically testing all of them to see which one operates the best.
But again, we're not away. I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
We see lots of ideas coming to the table now, so people are engaged in the subject. We see the beginning of sort of basic R&D sort of really kicking off now. We do worry about too much regulation too quick, and this sort of what we'd be forced into building gas generation then to meet that. So we see the sort of ingenuity of the American people and the university system, the national labs already engaged on this issue. They're not waiting for anything further.
But again, there's any of you, and I don't, I'm not saying that you should know, obviously. But any of you have any real idea of as to have we seen these technological breakthroughs coming from Europe, because they do seem to have some certainty. You know, has Europe become the bastion of CCS technological innovation?
I think the U.S. R&D program for CCS is among the best in the world. I think the Europeans are also doing a lot of work. They have gone farther on the policy and regulatory side than we have here in the States. But our research program is, the IEA did a study, and it called it the regional partnership program, specifically the world's most ambitious program. Unfortunately, that program is not very well known internationally, and I think we could do some programs to offer exchanges to get more experts like Dr. Finley in the international community and get some exchange happening.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I had to step away. We had action on the floor on a bill I'd worked on, ironically, on ocean acidification, so maybe appropriately so. But as I look at this capture and sequestration, I have a couple of questions that come to mind. I'll put those out there and maybe you can address them. One has to do with just estimated net capacity. In other words, how much are we able, you know, what's the band, the width of likely amount of carbon that we can capture, and time frame? The best climate change acidification scientists I know of say that we should shoot for nothing higher than 350 parts per million as a goal, and we already exceed that in terms of atmospheric loading of CO2, we already exceed that. And so my question is, how long is it going to take us to get some meaningful reduction in CO2 output, and what is the likely capacity we can? And my hunch is it's going to take a long time, and we're not going to be able to ultimately get that much out. And then the question for me is, should we not then focus on other modalities as a priority for our financial investment? I'll just put that out there, and whoever wants to take a swing at it, I'm happy to hear from.
They're all looking at me. From what I've read in the literature, including the IEA reports, if we're going to come down to some kind of a stabilization in the atmospheric concentrations or whatever level that is key, it shows that carbon capture and storage, along with the other mitigation measures, constitutes somewhere around 20%. Other reports say a little bit higher. That tells me that it needs to be an essential part of the portfolio of mitigation measures, along with efficiency, in-use efficiencies, nuclear, wind, solar, and natural gas. So it's very difficult to get to stabilization without looking at carbon capture and storage because of the existing inventory that we have out there that relies on fossil fuels. The other thing is that the storage capacity, at least in the United States, Dr. Finley could probably answer the question better than I. We've done a national atlas of the storage capacity in North America, and primarily Canada and the United States, and it shows that we have considerable storage capacity, several hundred years worth, and looking at the point sources where the power plants are and where the potential storage sites might be. And one of the reasons for looking at saline reservoirs is because that type of formation in the wet sands represent the majority of that storage capacity. And I defer to Dr. Finley to augment my statement on that.
Yeah, I can quote you the numbers from memory for the Illinois Basin just to give you a representative example. That region of Illinois, Indiana, and western Kentucky emits about 304 million metric tons of CO2 per year from stationary sources. 90% of those sources are coal-fired power plants. So we've got, say, a third of a billion tons. The storage capacity in the saline reservoirs that Dr. Durham mentioned is roughly between 27 and 109 billion metric tons. So we have at least probably in the order of at least 100 years of storage, possibly 400 years of storage in saline reservoirs in this region. The second version of the second edition of the Atlas that DOE has put forth has refined some of those early estimated numbers. The reality is that certainly 200 years worth of storage, if we could capture virtually all of the emissions from the known current stationary sources.
What about the time frame? When do we think we'll be able to do this?
I'll be happy to, or do you want to go later? I'll be happy to take that question. I think that the question of the time frame is really about what, if we don't, we haven't demonstrated it yet. We don't know if it can play. Right now, our analyses, as Dr. Durr mentioned, of how we're going to get to our global goals for climate change rely heavily on CCS. The IEA study says to cut 50% of the projected emission reductions that we need to cut by 2050, CCS is for 20%. So unless we demonstrate the technology, it's not going to play. So ultimately, I think the urgency is on demonstrating it, and how those demonstrations are going to go will depend on when we decide to do it.
And I would agree with that. I work with the Coal Utilization Research Council, and they're probably the most active at looking, at least for coal plants, what is the ramp to get from where we are now to what we would call commercially ready carbon capture and sequestration. So it's different than commercial availability. Commercial availability is when someone will sell you something. Commercially available to us means when is one of the banks accept it for financing, the regulations are set, we can build a strong business case with public service commissions signing on for that, for it to be ready. So to answer your question specifically, we're looking at a time frame of 2020 to 2025 if we're doing this demonstration sort of up ramp between then and now, so that we think at that point the utility industry would be ready to sort of start installing those as a normal matter of course. So when we look at that between now and then, we're looking at maybe 15 gigawatts, which might be as many as 30 plants, sort of as part of this demonstration and development and sort of different options. So in this route, we like a lot of duplication. That's not, great to hear, but we like different technologies. We think we need sequestration in different regions of the country for public acceptance, regulatory sort of thing. So in this case, it sounds like a lot, but we do need those parallel paths to get there.
I appreciate that. I'll close with just this concern. Is 2025 sounds like a long time away to me, given the urgency of the situation. We're already off our coast in the Northwest. We're seeing acidification rates that are presumably harming shellfish and other creatures. And 2025 is a long way away. And that's to start the installation of this, and that's at substantial additional cost per ton of coal burned. And so the question for me becomes economics, environmental impact, and practicality. It feels a little bit like, having followed the debates on fusion energy for 20, 30 years now myself, and it's always 20 or 30 years away, it feels a little bit like that, but I think the urgency is greater. Maybe your technology is more promising. I would hope it is, but I just want to put that a concern, and I would hope we would not see capture and sequestration as the deus ex machina that saves us. I think there may be other machinas, if not other deuses. I'm not sure. So, Dr. Ehlers.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As far as fusion is concerned, it used to be 20 to 30 years away. Now it's 30 to 40, so we're making progress. Yeah, right. Just call me Bernie Madoff of physics. I'm sorry I missed most of the hearing. I have four committee meetings going on simultaneously this morning, but just a quick question. In the brief time I've been here, I've heard a lot of different nations mentioned. I haven't heard Russia mentioned, which I believe has tremendous coal reserves. And are they an active player here? The second one is along the lines of the chairman's questions about when this is going to happen. I worry less about the science. We can do the science if we're willing to put the money in. I worry much more about getting acceptance throughout the international community that this is something that's fiscally and environmentally worth doing. And is there any indication that all the other nations are willing to join in doing this if we do? Because otherwise, we're given the use of coal throughout the world. Even if we do a marvelous job in this country, it doesn't really solve the problem. So I'd appreciate comments on those two questions.
With respect to Russia, in the international CCS meetings that I've attended, I haven't seen Russia participating. I don't know that they have a demonstration planned there, but there are a number of other countries worldwide who have plans for demonstrations similar to the FutureGen project. Australia has a project, China has a project, the Europe has planning 12, Canada has a project, so we do have quite a global commitment towards demonstrations of the technology.
And do we have a commitment towards implementation? That's the real key.
I don't think we have commitment towards implementation yet. I think we have commitment towards implementation, towards demonstrating the technology. I think we're moving towards a global suite of demonstration projects. I think implementation is the next step. And in some ways, we have to talk about implementation now because of the urgency of the climate challenge. But in other ways, you can't talk about it until you have at least one demonstration in the ground.
No, I agree, but that's the part that I'm very nervous about, and that was, as far as I was concerned, the failure of Kyoto from the start. I thought the general idea of Kyoto was good, but I had trouble supporting it because it was not made universal, and it doesn't make sense that we spend billions of dollars in this country and many other countries to try to stop something when other countries are not going to do it. And we'll just feel, you know, what we gain through our efforts, we lose through their efforts. So I think it's absolutely essential that there be strong international agreements if we're actually going to proceed with this. Thank you. I'll yield back.
Ms. Edwards.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And just an observation that, again, 2015 peak emissions, if we're right about our models, 2025, a demonstration projects at some point of commercialization that may or may not be successful. And so we're actually relying at this time, knowing that we're approaching peak CO2 emissions, on a technology that may or may not deliver in 2025. I mean, so we're banking on success here, and I want to ask you actually, you know, I want you to think about failure, because the cost for failure is really tremendous. Dr. Durr, I wonder if you could talk to me for a moment about, you know, if you think about the investment between now and 2025, what that investment would be. Does the department have any projections for that? And how much of a burden do taxpayers have to meet? And what's the relative risk then for private entities and other international partners?
That's a difficult question to answer at the moment. I think we have plans in terms of the projections of the research work and the demonstrations that are necessary. We engage with the private sector to get their views on the what's necessary to move things forward in terms of demonstrations and incentives for deployment. It's very important that we do the science correctly in the sequestration area, and I'm not an expert in it, but I do have a higher degree of confidence that it will work based on the work that's going on around the world and the experts that are being put to this particular topic, people like Dr. Finley and people from the regional partnerships. The Secretary is also committed to working on the back-end capture costs and its energy penalties associated with that, as well as the science in terms of simulations and looking at the risk assessments associated with that. All these things need to be done as part of the research and development and demonstration program. Relative to how these things get deployed and what the private sector investment is going to be is something that I don't have an answer to at the moment.
And just out of curiosity, do you have are you confident about your model for projecting the costs?
We have a research program that sets targets in terms of bringing down those costs from where they are now. We look at the research and the options that we've been pursuing, taking a look at what is its potential. And with those potentials, we have to change that and convert that into reality as we scale things up. And those are one of the challenges that one of the committee members here had also identified. But we really have to be able to engage the science and technology to bring down the cost and also to do the modeling and the field work and all those things associated with field demonstrations, drawing on experiences that we have had in the past from the oil and gas industry and looking at the natural analogs of CO2 that has been in the ground for millions and millions of years so that we can make these models and risk assessments going forward in time.
Okay, and then finally, just one question going back to Mr. Tonka's earlier question about water and the amount of water that it really takes to, that you project that it'll take to operate these plants. I'm curious about electricity and the amount of heat that is required and electricity required to generate to operate the plants and to function. And their estimates, I think in Mr. Monroe, in your testimony, estimates that 20% to 25% of the electrical output is required for operation. There are some estimates I've seen that are as high as 40%. And so if that's true, it's just really getting difficult to see where the bargain is.
Well, your earlier question talked about existing plants and why so much conversation about new plants, and your current question has something to do with that also. So if I go to an existing power plant today, let's say a medium-sized plant of 500 megawatts, I may lose a third of that generating capacity to add 90% CO2 capture to that. So there's two large pieces of that. One is the heat required in the capture process. That's about 20% in round numbers. The compression of the CO2 is around 10%. Right now, we would buy a large electric motor to compress the CO2 to get rid of it. We would actually take steam away from the process for this heat. We think in a new plant, again, talking conventional coal, that we may be able to integrate that and drop those numbers down. Right now, we're looking at numbers possibly as only 20%. So the new plant would be built that way. IGCC is actually much less than that, and that's why it's a favorite technology for new plants. We're building a new plant with that. The FutureGen is proposed for that. Duke is building one that may or may not have CO2 capture with it. And those are all sort of pioneer plants to try to develop that technology, just because we think the energy and therefore the cost for CO2 capture with that technology is, as we sit here looking today, is superior.
Of course, we have a lot of old plants. And then just lastly, Mr. Chairman, do we have any idea of what that'll mean to the consumer? Like, how much is my electric bill going to go up because we've made the choice to make an investment in something that is sucking out a lot of energy to produce, you know, the carbon capture?
So there's a lot of people estimating that, and so I'll talk about a specific, let's build a new plant. How much would the cost of electricity from that plant increase with carbon capture and sequestration? Based on some of the good work that the Department of Energy has done, that ranges from a 35% increase to as much as an 80% increase, depending on the technology. The high end are conventional coal plants like we're using today. The lower end is with the gasification plants. So it is significant, and that's really the reason for demonstrations, but also for the basic R&D, is to really attack that.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Edwards. We're going to have a vote in just a couple of minutes. I want to follow up with this line of questions of Ms. Edwards and a bit on the line I was asking before. If we look at the net expense of carbon capture sequestration over some time frame, and that would include the additional costs passed on to consumers, et cetera, the total net cost, And we considered how that money, you know, it's an opportunity cost kind of question. If we were to consider how that money might be spent elsewise, for example, instead of a concentrated power network going out across the grid, a distributed power network, the kind of thing Amory Lovins and his folks have talked about, how does that pencil out? Has anybody thought about this? Because it pencil out not only in terms of net economic cost benefit, but also in terms of time frame and carbon reduction. If we were to spend X amount of dollars today, we could start reducing carbon today versus waiting this long, and presumably that investment today would stimulate alternative investments in that technology, be it solar, small-scale wind, geothermal, et cetera. How does that pencil out? I mean, the people at the end of the day, they don't care whether the lights turn on because somewhere down the road there's a coal plant, a nuclear plant, or on the roof a solar plant. They want the lights to turn on, their house to be warm.
Well, I'm holding a pencil, so I'll try to answer that. I think, you know, you're going to hear in this committee over and over again, don't pick a winner. Don't pick a winner. Don't pick a winner as far as technologies. And in our view, there is a winner. It's fossil fuels, and we picked that for, or it ended up being picked for a reason, because it's relatively cheap and gives the most power, whether you're talking about powering your automobile or through electricity. And I think there is so much uncertainty associated with alternatives or making a change. But the bottom line is, it's going to cost more to do so. And I think the federal government has to consider what its role is going to be in all that. We talked about the private marketplace, but some would argue that, you know, let's send some signals to the market saying there's a rule about carbon. Is it constrained or it's priced? And let the market try to sort out that so we can move from a pencil to maybe some more ink. And I do think there's so much uncertainty and there's so many trade-offs with all these alternatives, whether you go with coal in the future or you look for wind or solar. Folks in Germany, for example, made a commitment to solar, but they're paying more because of it. They've guaranteed a price for it. But that's a choice they have made. And you're right, I don't know if, you know, this will be acceptable to people. If the PSC today says, you know, we're going to approve a rate increase for carbon capture and storage, how's that going to go over with their ratepayers?
Well, I want to just follow up, Mr. Gaffigan. You said in our view, does that mean GAO has an official position that I want to ask two questions.
Sure.
I'm not really trying to put you on the spot. I'm just curious about this.
Right.
When you talk about it relatively cheap, my colleague, Mr. Inglis, talked about the externalized cost.
Right, right.
It's relatively cheap if you externalize the cost. If you factor in the total costs of ocean acidification and lethal overheating of the planet, it's not so relatively cheap.
No, it's what we're actually charging for it, and that's the question, whether we want to try to put a cost on some of those externalities. If we do so, then the ratepayers are going to, somebody's going to have to pay for it.
Right, somebody has to pay for it one way or the other is the point. You don't get to not pay for an acidified ocean. You don't get to not pay for a climate, a 2 or 3 degrees centigrade climate change. You don't get to not pay for that. That's going to happen.
Right.
The question is who's paying for it and who's responsible for it, and that's not something we can pretend we don't pay for.
And we could spend all the money we want on technologies, but that's not going to make the difference.
I'm not sure of that.
Dr. Well, in terms of...
I just wanted to follow up on the statement here. The climate change in greenhouse gas and CO2 emissions is a global issue, and price signals that happen in the United States or Europe could probably put certain technology out there at a certain cost. But in the developing economies who may not have certain price signals and continue to use coal, such as in China and India, they may not do that. They may, but it's at these additional costs today, it's very expensive for us. It's overwhelmingly expensive for them. Therefore, I think the solution out of the box, if you will, really is these game-changing technologies that we need to work on to bring that cost down so that it's affordable not only by us, whether we have certain levels of a carbon valuation or not, but also in the developing countries and economies that are going to be growing and looking for a better standard of living.
Mr. Inglis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, this has been very helpful hearing, particularly this last exchange about how do you get from here to there. Because what I think we should be aware of is until we do what we've just been talking about, which is attach a price, there'll be no reason to go forward. We had great science projects, and we on the Science Committee love science projects. But until entrepreneurs and inventors are marrying each other because a price signal has been sent that now something is going to happen and you can make money doing it, you can make money solving this problem. Until that happens, nothing happens. And we keep on, we have hope, but hope is not a strategy. And so what I'd particularly offer to Dr. Durr to take back to the administration is, Let's come up with something that works. As a conservative, I can tell you that there's very little chance that conservatives are going to vote for a cap and trade system. It's a massive tax increase. By itself is a massive tax increase. Also, in the aftermath of this financial downturn, do we really want to hand over to Wall Street traders some credits that they can trade? Maybe they can turn them into derivatives. And maybe we can do a bubble out of the derivatives. And maybe we can see what a wild ride we get out of that. So, not going to happen. There were 48 votes for cloture in the Senate this summer when it got tagged as a tax increase. In the midst of a downturn and with Wall Street looking like it looks, what's the chance of that number going north of 48? Answer, not very much. So, even if the House decides to run it through the House just on a cap-and-trade system, it's dead on arrival in the Senate. So if you really want to take action, you got to find something better. And the collaborative opportunity I think we've got is a revenue-neutral carbon tax, if I may be so bold to suggest it, where you reduce payroll taxes and you apply a tax to carbon, transparent, very clear price signal, very definitive price signal. You know exactly where we're going. Entrepreneurs and inventors know when to get married and when their technology can take out the incumbent technology. And it's an exciting opportunity, really, to bring the best of Republican thought, conservative thought, which is how markets work when they're properly adjusted. In other words, where you have externalities recognized and attached to products. And the best of Democratic thought, which is for a long time, Ben, we got to do something. So we put those two together and we get a solution that works, that actually could get through the House and maybe even through the Senate. and they could get buy-in, and then we could get this energy revolution to happen, like happened, as I mentioned earlier, with the PC and the internet. So I'm excited about the opportunity available to us if we would but collaborate. If we ramp, if we try to run this thing up the middle, up the middle, up the middle punt series of plays, that's what we'll end up with, a punt. That's when...
That's called the Seattle Seahawks.
Yeah, that's it. I went to Duke for college, and when we got frustrated in the stands, that's what we would cheer about the football team. Up the middle, up the middle, up the middle punt. You know, that's what we are facing if we try it just that sort of way. But if we think outside the box and say, here's something that we could actually come together on and find a solution. I've been talking to the new secretary about that. I think there's a real opportunity here, I hope that this hearing helps helps speed it on. I went to making a speech there, Mr. Chairman, rather than asking a question. But
well, let's ask the question. Can we ask our witnesses if they have some comments on Mr. Inglis's thoughts here?
Yeah. I would just wrap up and say that. You know, I think they're both important. I mean, I think technology plays a role. I think whatever signal we're going to send about carbon is important. And Geo recently did a study on the whole issue of climate change. And talking to a lot of experts, they both agreed that both play a role, the R&D role and the sending the right signals or a signal of some time that gives some certainty to folks. And they can't exist without each other.
I would just add one comment. I think the portfolio approach is important. Every aspect of efficiency, renewables, and carbon sequestration is necessary to get where we want to go. And I would note that the Congress has passed some very significant mandates with respect to alternative fuels, biofuels, ethanol, and so forth. And from that fermentation process, you get a 99% pure stream of CO2. And you avoid some of the costs that Mr. Monroe referred to. So let's do it incrementally. We can take pure CO2 from a biofuel facility, and we can put it in the ground now. And let's do that sooner rather than later while we reduce the cost of the parasitic load, the energy load on the power plants that Mr. Monroe referred to.
You know, it's very important, Dr. Finley, you just mentioned the mandates. That is one way to go. The challenge with that is it's not as elegant and efficient as a pure price signal, because then competing technologies are out there in the private sector, and some of them will win, some of them will lose. If we from up here do a mandate of various sorts, and I've voted for mandates, higher CAFE standards, for example, but you don't get the innovation, the rapid innovation that you could get if you did it more elegantly by price signaling.
Well, I would certainly agree with your point on that, but the mandates are there, and particularly as we move forward with, say, with cellulosic or waste product ethanol type fuels, rather than corn to ethanol or food to ethanol, and avoid that fuel versus food debate, I think there's something to be gained there. Yeah. And given that those mandates are in place, and presumably there are people out there making an effort to meet them.
We would agree. I mean, we like flexibility there. So on one end, sort of the mandate cap and trade somewhere in the middle. We get some flexibility under the cap of where to do that. We like a pure price signal so that new innovations can come in. We don't have to go back to the regulatory sort of arena to sort of incorporate those, and sort of like the way that spurs it. Southern Company has a large research staff, and so we like really thinking out of the box, and that encourages it.
Dr. Ehlers?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, let me say I'll be happy to match our 0-16 Detroit Lions against Seattle Seahawks any day. We don't even go up the middle. We just throw interceptions. It's much more efficient.
Let's hope our energy policy can exceed both of those records. And,
yes, absolutely. I also want to thank Mr. Inglis's comments. He's always very thoughtful on these issues and has thought deeply about them, and what he says makes a lot of sense. I would say that part of the problem with the proposed cap-and-trade program is not even a cap-and-trade program. It's a simple tax. It's an energy tax, and that's why it's never going to fly. cap and trade in a pure form might work once you get the markets going, but it's not going to be easy. But if you started out as a straight tax, I agree with you, it's destined to failure. But I think much of what you said is valid, and I think, you know, the energy situation overall over a 20-year period is so desperate that we really have to try every option possible and develop the best approach we can. And I think the marketplace is a good place to try many of the experiments. It gives you a fairly direct, fairly quick answer. So with that, I'll yield back. Thank you.
I'll just observe that I think one of the ironies of the cap and trade debate has been that I think the cap and trade model was put forward as a way of trying to use conservative capitalistic values to justify investment in environmental protection and CO2 reduction. So the incentive was there, and yet I think the opponents of it are coming from the same side that it was designed to appeal to. My own leaning is much more towards the line of Mr. Inglis. The only thing I would observe on that is it's easy to denigrate any form of tax, because the indirect form, externalized form of tax, government doesn't impose, nature imposes on it, and nature may actually impose a much higher rate of taxation in the form of consequences if we don't tax ourselves to try to reduce CO2 and other gas emissions. This has been a very, very informative discussion. We're very grateful for all of your time, and I thank very much my colleagues for their thoughtful input as well. And with that, and with the buzzing going off, the hearing will stand adjourned again with the gratitude of the committee. Thank you very much.